Hello, everybody, and welcome to Schwab Coaching. My name is Lee Bowl. I'm one of the education coaches here at Schwab. Joined today in the chat by everybody's favorite coach, JB, James Boyd. So we want to thank him for covering for me there. I got a question for you. The market has pulled back a little bit. How do you actually find pullbacks, not just that have pulled back, but have pulled back to support? That'll be the focus of today's presentation, among a few other things. So before we can get to all that good stuff, though, just a few logistical items. So keep in mind that everything we're doing today is for educational and informational concepts only. We will be looking at real symbols, but they are not recommendations. We might do some example trades, but again, they are not recommendations. Also, this is about technical analysis. We will talk a lot about technical analysis, but Schwab certainly does not recommend the use of technical analysis as your sole method of investment research. Also, if you are trading in the paper money side of thinkorswim, remember that results in paper money don't always translate into real-time trading with real money. Also, for sake of simplicity, in this presentation, we are not including any fees or commission. And I think we all know that investing has some risks to it, risk of principal. So with that, I'm just going to put up a chart here of the S&P 500. And I'm doing this because reading some of the surveys about some of my classes here, there was a few questions about some of the market timing studies that I showed you, and two in particular. So the first one was, I showed you something that was developed by Tom McClellan, of the McClellan family, not the McClellan of the McClellan oscillator, but in the same family. And it was based on the VIX. So I'm just going to go over that real quick because I want to just answer that question. So I'm going to change my layout here and I'm going to go to the VIX layout to explain what we are seeing. All right. So this market timing system is based on the VIX. We'll look at the last few signals, but first let's understand what it's trying to accomplish. So we have a chart up here. I have a 3-year, 1-day chart of the VIX, which is the candles. Above and below them, or on these bands, these are Bollinger bands, but they have a different setting than the default. All right. As you know, the default on Bollinger Bands is a 20-period measure of central tendency, defined as a moving average, and then the bands are set up by standard deviations above or below, with the default being 2 above and 2 below, right? Now, this particular setup uses Bollinger Bands, but with a different setting. The settings are, the measure of central tendency is a 50-period moving average, and the bands are set 1 standard deviation above and below. All right, so how do you use it? Well, the theory is you want to watch the upper Bollinger Band. So I actually don't need both of these Bollinger Bands on this chart. I just need the upper one, but I have them both on there, okay? And the theory is if you start, you got to watch the slope of the upper band. And I've got the last few signals over the last 3 years here for you, just to show you how this can be used, all right? So what you're looking for is a change in slope that is, you know, reasonable. What I mean by that is it's got to be more than just a little dip, right? So watch the Bollinger Band here back in April a couple of years ago was kind of flat. Notice here how it started dropping. Right. When you go from either an up slope or horizontal slope to a down slope, that means that over a longer period of time, volatility is dropping a little bit, which sometimes can mean that the market is beginning to trend. And you can see this is the signal on this particular one. You keep in that until the Bollinger Band starts turning back up the other way. So this was this trade here worked out okay. Then we were kind of flat in here. You know, as I said, it's got to be a dramatic change in slope, which we had basically coming in here. So here the slope of the upper Bollinger Band went up, And in fact, this is the signal, the market sold off. All right, here the band started dropping again, the market rallied. So that is how you use this indicator. Right now, what is it saying? Well, let's zoom in here. It's saying right now, if you follow the methodology, that we're still in a longer term uptrend because this is still continuing to go down. And that particular move started right about here. You can see this line right here. It is still in effect. So I did want to point that out. Okay. The second question I got was, I had posted this on X as well. The McClellan oscillator had switched to negative, but I wanted to go over a couple of ways to look at that and also make a point about it matters what exchange you're looking at. All right. So let's do that as well. So what I'm going to do here then is I'm going to go back to my regular workspace. And I'm going to get this chart a little bit bigger. And what I'm going to do is put up the SPX. All right. And I'm going to add the McClellan oscillator here, which I have as a study set. All right. For those not familiar, remember that the McClellan oscillator is a momentum measure of the advance to decline line. Okay. So there's different signals that are available. The first is when it drops below zero, some traders consider that a sign to get a little bit more defensive. And you can see it worked here. I put this on my Twitter when it went negative for the first time in a while, right? Actually, the first time since October. All right. So you can see we did sell off. Now, when do you get back in? There are two ways, just like with the MACD. All right, there's two ways. You can either wait until the actual line crosses back above zero. That would be like the MACD going from below zero to above zero. Or you can look at the change of the slope if you want to be a little bit more aggressive. And right now we see that it is flattened and maybe it's beginning to turn up. Another day or two, we might know that. You can see when the slope turns up, even though it's below zero, sometimes you do get a little heads up, okay? So the slope turned right in here below zero, and that's when we took off. So that is certainly something to take a look at as well. The classic signal is when it goes back above zero. But again, if you want to get a little bit more aggressive, then you can look at the change of slope of the line. Now, the other thing I wanted to point out on this one was, but I trade the NASDAQ more stocks than like the S&P stocks. There is a, I want to show you something on this indicator. All right, let's put up the NASDAQ composite. All right, so the advance to decline line isn't going to help us very much because it's on the New York, and the McClellan oscillator is on the New York. What we want to know though, all right, is let's go ahead and modify it so it makes more sense. So what we're going to do, notice you can pick the three exchanges. Remember, you need advanced declines on an exchange, okay? So if we chose NASDAQ here, all right, then we're going to basically look at this for the NASDAQ. And we see on the NASDAQ, it looks like the sell-off still might be continuing a little bit as the slope is still down, okay? So we saw on the New York Stock Exchange, McClellan, which often is very similar to the SPX, that we were beginning to turn up. This one is still a little bit down. So it may be for traders using that particular system just a little bit early, perhaps, to buy into a pullback yet if you're using that methodology. All right. Now, the next thing, where do you find the McClellan oscillator? Yeah, you don't have to build it. It's right in the studies. So if we go to edit studies, and let's go McClellan, MCCL, CCL, all right? And here it is. I've got a modification on it as well where I just have it showing some signals, but you can just use the regular one here and just pull it over, all right? Now, also on the advance to decline one, I wanted to show you this as well. You can get it on the NASDAQ too. So we want to show that as well as the McClellan, right? Because that's going to look a little bit different perhaps, than the advance to decline line on the New York. So you can change it for the index that you're looking at. So I wanted to make that clear as well. All right. Now, as I said in my opening remarks, the market has been selling off. It looks like, you know, we haven't broken any main moving average levels on some of the indices, you know, the 50 or the 100 or something like that. If we put up, let's put up the SPX here just for a second. And we'll put up some moving averages on here. All right. So we're above the 200, we're above the 100. And I'm going to make this a little bit darker. Oops, I want to move it. I want to make it darker. There we go. We'll make it black just so you can see it a little bit better. Have a dotted line. We'll make it 3 here. All right. So we're above all the major moving averages of the intermediate to longer term strength. Okay. Now, what we're going to do next is look for pullbacks. But the problem with pullbacks, because the market has pulled back, we should have some candidates for pullbacks. But what we want to know is which stocks are pulling back to a place where support might be. And how are you going to do that? So what we're going to do here is I'm going to show you how to build a scan. We're going to go step by step. We're going to make it more and more restrictive with different ideas, and then you can add the ideas in, you can take them back, all right, and make it less restrictive. But I want to also show you how to use the condition wizard, all right, for those of you who like think scripting a little bit. So let us start. All right, so what we're going to be doing is looking for pullbacks in different time frames. The scan that we're going to build will allow you to pick your time frame to look for the pullbacks. And what is the support level that we are going to look for pullbacks to? We shall look for pullbacks to significant moving averages. All right, that'll be the support that we are looking for. So we need to build a screen where we are getting stocks that have been trending. We're going to do uptrend pullbacks right now because that's what the market is telling us. Stocks that have been going up in a longer term basis, but have pulled back to a moving average. And then we're going to get those, but then we're going to add a few other criteria to those, perhaps. You know, maybe we want it taking out the high of the previous day. Maybe we want a low volume pullback. I'm going to show you this scan where you can do all of that. And you can change the moving averages. So it's a very interesting scan that I use all the time. All right. So we're going to start building it. So the way we do this is we're going to go over to the scan tool. All right. And I'm just going to get rid of everything right now. Not that. Yeah, remove all filters. Okay, so the first thing we need to do, so we're going to do this step by step. And on each step that we do, we are going to look at the candidates just to make sure that each step that we are adding is correct. And are we getting what we want? All right, because if you do a lot of things all at once on a scan, you don't know if it doesn't work, what is not working. Right. So if you build it step by step and keep looking, then you'll know if, you know, the scan is working fine. And then we put in another criteria and we get 0. Maybe that criteria is the problem. We can take it out and try again. All right. So let us start. All right. So the first thing we need is stocks that are going up in whatever time frame we want. I'm going to use an intermediate term time frame for the uptrend, and we're going to have a shorter term pullback within that. All right. Okay. So here's how we're going to do that. We're going to scan in the S&P 500, and we are not going to do this. We're going to remove this. All right. Now we're going to add we don't need this. All right, so we're going to start with the S&P 500. Now, if you're interested in doing this in a particular industry, you could do it by industry too, right? If you're looking for a particular one. We're just going to do scan in the S&P 500s. And the first thing we're going to do is add a filter. not to add condition group. I'm gonna. Okay, so. I want to get my scan back. I need to get rid of this one. It wasn't there a second ago. All right, so let's do all of the following add filter. We're going to start to try to get our uptrend. Okay, so how are we going to do that? We are going to use the condition wizard. All right, so we're going to go here to here. We're going to open it up. You don't need six sync scripting for this part. All right, so we're going to delete this and we're going to add a condition. And the condition we want is a study. And the study that we want is a simple moving average. So how do you get uptrends in a particular time frame? What you can do is compare two moving averages and have a simple moving average of a shorter length have a value greater than a moving average with a longer length, which means the shorter term price action is stronger than the longer term. That might give you a stock that is uptrending, right? So what we're going to say is, why don't we do, we'll start off with a really long term to have a longer term trend in here. So we'll do the 100-day moving average is greater than the 200-day. So we'll change this to 100 and we'll say it's greater than. The 200. All right, so we got 250 here stocks, okay? And now let's just look at them. As I said, every step we're going to take a look. Let's take a look at, ACN and just make sure that the 100-day moving average is above the 200, okay? So that's working, all right? Now let's get a little bit more recent strength. Let's add again. We're gonna do it again, just what we did before, but we are gonna do it with two shorter moving averages, okay? To get a more intermediate term strength. So study again, simple moving average. This time we're gonna say we want the 50-day greater than the 100. Okay. All right, now we've got it down to 50. Again, let's take a look at AFL just to make sure that we've done everything that we need. All right, so we have the 100 above the 200 and we have the 50 above the 100. So this is what gives us both a longer term uptrend and a shorter term uptrend as well. Again, if you're a very short term trader, you could do it again with the 20 above the 10. One thing I should mention, yeah, I see it in there. If you want to use studies, you got to do the scan in your regular TOS account. And then if you want to trade the candidates in your paper money, just write down the symbols and you can trade them in paper money. But to do the scan with studies, you do need the regular account. All right, so that's so far so good. All right, next. Oops. The next thing we want to do is, and this is the tricky part, all right? And this you need a little scripting for. Now, and I will I'll share this with you after the end. But what we're going to do here is, this is the heart, if you will, of this scan. And this is what gives it the flexibility. All right. So what we're going to do is add another study filter. All right. We're going to open it up. We're going to take off this one. But now this is the important part. Okay. Instead of doing the condition wizard this time, because this is a little bit more complicated, we're going to go to the Think Script Editor. And I've written a little program here. And here is the code. So I'm just going to pop in this code in there. All right, so let's go over how this is set up, because you need to understand this code to make it flexible. All right, so let's start. So this just says that I wrote it, okay? So input price. So this allows you to, when you do inputs like this, you can change things in the script without having to do a lot of work. So we're using closing prices for this, all right? This is where you put in the moving average length where you want the pullback to. And you can change it, right? Right now it's 20, but if you wanted to pull back to the 50-day moving average, you just change that to 50. If you want a short-term pullback to the 10-day moving average, you could put the 10 there. If you want to pull back to the 200-day moving average, okay, you can put 200 in there, all right? And average type is simple. Now you can use all different types of moving averages if you want. I know JB uses the whole moving averages. You could use that. All right. And then we want it to be around that moving average. How do we do that? So this part of it, remember when you put a number sign in front of anything you write in the editor, it's not a code. It's just a note. So what I did was I said, I want, and you can change this, but I want this particular stock to a pullback within 1.5%, okay, and either above or below the moving average. So we don't need it right there. We just need it around there, all right? So you can change that to 1%. You could change it to 2%, all right? And then that will find stocks that are doing that, all right? So let's do okay here. All right. Now we have 50 stocks, all right, that should have been pulled back to the 20-day moving average. So let's just see if that's true or not. I think we all know AMD, right? Let's take a look at AMD. Now, before I put in that chart, what I'm going to do is we have to put in the moving average we're looking at, right? So I'm just going to put up the 20-day moving average here. So I'm going to remove all these, and I'm going to just do a chart. I'm just going to add the 20-day. And remember to change the parameters of an indicator. All right. We click on the little gear thing and we're gonna make this 20 day. And so we can see it better, I'm gonna make it orange and I'm gonna make it nice and thick. I'm gonna put it on the chart. All right. All right, so there's the 20 day moving average. Now, AMD, let's see AMD. Did we get what we wanted? Kind of looks like it, doesn't it? We have an uptrending stock that has pulled back to a moving average and now seems to be going back above it, okay? So for many traders, this might be a particular setup, all right? Some traders might put a stop under the pullback low or under the support that you can see here also. And we might come back to this for an example trade later, but we're just doing it step by step right now. Okay. All right. So that's to get a pullback to the 20-day moving average. Let's try it with a different moving average length and just see if it still works. All right. Let's try the 50-day or the 100-day. But then we're going to add even more stuff to it to kind of fine tune it. All right. So let's go back to our scan. All right. So if we want to change it to a pullback to a 50-day moving average, what we need to do is go into the code on that thing I showed you there. And we're going to change this to 50. So that's why you got to know the code. Just, you don't have to know the code, but you'd have to know where to put in the variable that you want. And if you set it up this way, you can just change the variable here. Okay. So we'll do that. And then we will rerun it. And now we should be getting stocks pulling back to the 50-day moving average, perhaps. So the first thing we're going to do is go back to the chart. Let's change this moving average to a 50 and see what we have. And just so we'll make it a different color, just so we can. There's a 50 day. Now, what do we got here? We got AFL, Electronic Arts is in takeover. You don't look at that. We got Amazon. We could look at a couple of these. Uh-huh. We have a pullback to around the 50 day moving average. All right, let's see Amazon. Oops. Did we get what we wanted? I would say so. All right. I mean, that's a pullback to the 50-day moving average on Amazon. That is a support level. But now let's add something else, because this is just a pullback to the moving average, right? It doesn't mean that we're going to reverse necessarily. Maybe we could add into this the fact that we want, not only has it pulled back to a moving average, but it is taking out the previous day's high, which could be a sign, right, of a bounce on that moving average. So let's go back to the 20 day, and because we had more candidates for that one. Let's go back here and do a 20 day pullback. Okay, but now we're going to add in that next criteria. So what we're going to do again is add another filter. Again, we open it up. This time we can use the condition wizard, all right? So we take this one away. This time though, for the condition, we use price. Okay, not study, not value, not function, but price. All right. And what we want is the high today to be greater than the high from the previous day, right? So we go, we want the high to be greater than the high from yesterday, which is one day back. So that's the offset. That's how you do that. All right. If you wanted to take out the high from 2 days ago, you put in a two there. All right. Now, this probably will narrow down the list a bit. Let's see. So AMD is in there. What else? BAC. Now, that has earnings coming up, as you know, but let's just take a look at the chart. So let's change this to a 20 again. Remember, I changed it so we're looking for 20-day pullbacks. All right, let's put in BAC. Aha! We pull back to within 1.5% of the moving average. Have we taken out the high of the previous day? Yeah. All right. Let's look at another one. Where's my skin? Okay. Let's look at, we know AMD, but that, so not only did we see it last time, we also know from this scan that the AMD is also the highest taking out yesterday's high. Let's revisit that one. Scan, you know, let's zoom in here. And what do we have? A pullback within 1.5% of the moving average. The high is greater than yesterday's high. Now on this one, some traders might say, I would, since we faded a little bit from the high and we're right around the moving average, some traders might put this on a watch list just to see if it closes above there. Okay. So that's good. And yes, this is recorded and I'm going to give you the code for all this too. Now, some traders, so we've narrowed it down quite a bit, haven't we? We've got a pullback to a moving average where we are seemingly bouncing, at least from the previous day. But some traders like low volume pullbacks. So maybe we could add into this that the volume in the pullback is less than the volume in the up move, right? Why don't we add that into our scan and see what we get? At some point, we're going to add so many criteria that it's too restrictive. So when I share the code, you got to decide how many of these that you want. All right. But because the market is pulled back itself, we have a lot of candidates. Now, sometimes you won't. And there, maybe you wouldn't make it quite as restrictive. So let's go back to the scan and put in that volume idea. Okay. So let's go back to the scan. Let's add another filter. Study. Open it up. It always defaults to ADX crossover. Although I have used that in other scans, right? Now we're going to add a condition. All right, so let's just think what we want here. We want the volume in the pullback to be less than the volume as we went up. All right, so how are we going to do that? So the first thing we're going to do is go to study, and we're going to look at volume. And we want volume average. Okay. All right. Now, here is the trick on this one. Okay. If you're using the volume average, you've got to change the plot. All right. All right. Now, what I said was I wanted the volume in the pullback to be less than the volume over the move. Now, this is kind of trial and error to a certain extent, but what we're going to do is we're going to say, I want the volume for the last 4 days, because that momentum pullbacks tend to be 3 to 5 days, but we don't want to count today's volume. So we got to offset this by one. So this will be the last 4 days, not counting today, the average volume is less than the volume, okay, when it was going up, and in our time frame, that's about a month. Now, you could do it with a 50-day volume, you could do it, but we're going to use 20 days worth of volume, all right, in here. So what we're going to do is we want study. Volume average. Again, change this to volume average, all right? All right, now I'm going to change this to 20. And we don't want to include today's volume either, so we're going to offset this by one. All right, now we'll have to see how this, if this decimates the list or not, okay? Now. We got, so a lot of these that we already saw now have that volume criteria. Let's look at it one we haven't looked at yet. How about, I don't know, the home builders have been doing, let's look at D.H. Horton. All right, so look at this. Pull back to the 20-day moving average. Here was the volume on the up move. You can see the volume in this pullback, while it was up a little bit, is much lower than the up move, right? So now we have a low volume pullback to a moving average, all right? So That is what I wanted to show you. And remember, you can go in there, change the code, and get pullbacks to any moving average. You don't have to put in the volume if you don't want. But what I'm going to give you now, I will give you the, I will share this scan with all this stuff in it, and you can always take out some. All right. So let's do that. All right. So let's go ahead and share this scan. So first, I'm going to save it for myself. Actually, I already have it saved, so I'll just share it. All right, so I'm going to put this as pullback. This one is with, well, I should say pullback to moving average of your choice with volume. Okay. All right. So quick share. All right, and now I'm going to put this in the chat for you. I'll also put it in the notes if you want to watch this on the recording. All right, now I have several interesting questions in here. Could you add the RSI to get it oversold? Sure, you can add that. We'd have to see. All right, so Chuck 50 wants us to throw it in. All right. And can we throw in the RSI higher than the previous day? We can do that too. How do you do that? Let's do it. Now, I haven't done this, okay? So this is new for both of us, but I'm trying to answer the question and let's see what we get. So how would we do that, everybody? Yeah, keep in mind that these scans will work on thinkorswim Schwab. They won't work right away on thinkorswim TD Ameritrade. They might work in a day or two. Just keep that in mind. Okay, so we need to add another filter to do what the question is here. So let's go here to add another filter, study. Now, with the other thing we could do here too is, you know, we could say we want an oversold RSI, but the problem with using RSI for pullbacks, okay, is that in uptrending stocks, you often don't get oversold RSI readings. Oversold in uptrends is somewhere between 40 to 50-ish, and you never know exactly where. All right, so that's why I like to, at least some traders like the moving average part of it, so you know that you're pulling back to support and you don't have to have a specific RSI value. But the question was at least to have the RSI showing that the pullback may be over. So today's RSI is less than yesterday, is more or higher than RSI. Okay, all right. So let us go do that as well. So we're going to take this off, add a condition, study. RSI. All right. So it depends on, you know, some people use 10 here. Okay. Some use 14. I'm going to keep it at 14. Does anybody know where the 14 comes from? If you read Mr. Wilder's book, it comes from half a lunar month. He was big on lunar months, all right? There's 28 days in a lunar month, so this is half. Okay. All right. Let us go ahead and say we want the RSI today to be greater than. Again, I don't know if we're going to get any, but I'm just trying to answer the question. All right, greater than RSI yesterday. All right, so we'll rerun it. Before we do that, let's put the RSI on the chart. So when you go back and check, okay? Let's put the RSI on the chart here. All right. So now let's go do the scan. You get some of the sames. Let's take a look at Ross Stores. Yeah, so we got a pullback to the 20-day moving average. You can see the volume in the pullback was less than the volume in general going up. The high today is greater than yesterday's high. Okay. And the RSI value is higher than the day before. You can see it's just a little bit higher. So yeah, you could add that in there as well. All right. All right, so let's just review what we talked about. So we wanted to build a scan, which is something that we could use for different time frames. We changed the time frame of the pullback. Here's by choosing the moving average we want the pullback to, or changing the moving averages lengths to give us the uptrend, right? We could have done the 10 greater than the 20 greater than the 50 or something like that. And just to show you, for shorter term traders, this does work. Let's take off the RSI here for a second and let's change it to a 10-day moving average for a better momentum pullback. Okay. And let us go here and change that. So we need this one here. And let's change the moving average to 10. All right. So now, before we look at these, let's put 10 on the chart. So it changes to a 10-day. All right, and so what do we have here? We had the Bank of America again. We had Horton. Let's look at Bank of New York Mellon. Aha! Pull back to the 10-day moving average, which has been really good on this one. Let's look in here. The high took out yesterday's high. The volume is less generally than the volume in the consolidation, as you can see. So this gives us exactly what we want. All right. So remember, if you're trying to do this in paper money, you can't do it. You'll get, you are not permission for study filter. So you've got to run the scan if you want to use it for your paper trade, and you got to run the scan in your real account, and then you can take the candidates, you know, put them in a watch list and put it in your paper money account if you want to trade them. All right, so let's just review what we talked about. I gave you a scan. I gave you the code. I'll put the code in the notes. I don't have access to the TD, the thinkorswim from TD Ameritrade. So I could build it in there if I had access to it. So maybe I'll do that, but anyway, I'll post this in the notes and I'll also post it on my Twitter feed, this particular scan. So I think it's quite useful and I hope that you enjoyed it. So thank you very much for your kind attention. I want to thank James for doing a workmanlike job in the chat. And we have recorded this one, so you'll be able to watch it in detail at a slower pace if that's a requirement for you. So again, thanks, James. Thanks, everybody. And have a nice weekend.